recording.
I'd like to invite the congregation to join on the prelude, 385, all the persons of all people that on earth as well.
Grace and peace be to you from God, our Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I want to welcome you to this service for First Presbyterian Church here in Pilot Mountain this Sunday, August 21st, 2022. A few announcements that need to be made. This month's needs for Pilot Outreach are toilet paper, bar soap, and shampoo. Blessing box items can be placed either in the box directly on Needham Street or left in the hallway closet behind the choir back here. The November Bazaar, the Pat Blackwater Bazaar, is being held in November. And those shoes or clothing are accepted, but items can be brought in and left in the Sunday school room in the fellowship hall. Our flower sign-up sheet, starting September 1st, there are no sign-ups until mid-October, so if you are wanting to remember or honor someone during that time, Please write your information on the sign-in sheet that's located in the office lobby off to my right. Our session meeting is tomorrow night in Fellowship Hall at 7 o'clock. If you have anything that you would like to see done or have concerns, please see myself or one of the elders, and we will take that up tomorrow evening. Are there any announcements that we might have missed at this time?
We have some guests, choir members today.
All right.
Paul, he will be coming into the choir. And we have as a guest Rachel Collins, and we have our commissioner, one of our town commissioners, by the way. Honored to have her. And then back to the back is Ryland Smith, who was a little leaguer, baseball star with his team, Alan Sunrise. He was also the bell ringer.
Well, thank you for being here. Thank you for joining us this morning. If there are no more announcements, would you please stand as you are able and join me in our call to worship. God is our rock and our fortress, our refuge and our strength.
God is our hope and our trust. Praise the Lord.
Let us worship God. You may be seated.
Second verse,
say that we have no sin, we are found to be lying, and God is not with us. So let us stand as you are able, joining together, confessing to both God and to each other in our unison prayer of confession. Let us pray. God of light, you come to us as a consuming fire, and the one who has consecrated us before time. You promise us a kingdom that cannot be shaken, and call us to serve you with praise and thanksgiving. But we forget and yield to fear. We trust in the tangible rewards of this world and neglect your promises. We confess that we are a divided people. We foster separations and wide rifts in our families, our communities, and in the world. Open us to your healing. Free us from all that distances us from your presence. Give us your grace and inspire us to serve you with courage. Through Jesus Christ, who comes to save. Amen. And promising forgiveness and the sustenance that we need to amend our lives. God rejoices in our longing for wholeness. Give thanks that we have been able to be known and forgiven, set free to live the resurrected life of faith. Thanks be to God. Second reading is found in the book of the prophet Jeremiah, chapter 1, verses 4 through 10. Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Before I formed you in the Then I said, "Ah, Lord God, truly I do not know how to speak, for I am only a boy." But the Lord said to me, "Do not say, 'I am only a boy,' for you shall go to all to whom I send you, and you shall speak whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord." Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth, and the Lord said to me, "Now I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and over kingdoms, to pluck up and to pull down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant." These are the words of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. In the fading hours of Saturday, April 17th, 1506, a lone traveler was riding fast from the city of Rome. He was riding toward his own home territory, which in those days Italy was not united. Cities controlled the areas around them. And he was checking over his shoulder to see if he had been followed. His escape had come when he left his place of work and fled through a little-known gate in the walls of Rome. But the man who was fleeing had eyes and ears in other places and most everywhere. And sooner rather than later, the agents of the Pope Julius II were smashing the door of the inn where Michelangelo had stopped for a bit of sleep and some food. Michelangelo was able to tell the Pope's agents that no, he would not go back to the Holy City, because that area of Italy where he was controlled by the city of Florence. Besides that, he told the Pope in a letter, he believed there was a plot against his life and that he would be buried rather than the Pope. It's lots of sweet talking and stroking of the ego to finally get him to return to Rome, but Julius was not a man to be deterred. When he returned, Michelangelo fully expected to go back to the job which he had been commissioned to do, which was sculpt the tomb of Julius to remember as the greatest of all of his works and a list of great works he had already done. But when he met with Julius, he was infuriated to discover that Julius had a different job for him. Julius wanted frescoes of the Sistine Chapel to be painted and was willing to pay a handsome price to have it done. Michelangelo refused. His reason was, "I'm a sculptor, not a painter." Now imagine that if you've ever seen Star Trek and the voice of Dr. McCoy. "Dang it, Your Holiness, I'm a sculptor, not a painter." But in the end, he was persuaded to do the ceiling. And then a strange thing happened. Michelangelo decided he was going to do a good job for this. Part of it was his ego. Raphael had already done several frescoes in the building, and Michelangelo did not want him to claim that his work was superior. But there was also his faith that came into his work, and probably his best known work. He was initially commissioned to do the 12 apostles on the central section of the ceiling. He went back to the Pope and said, "For double the money, I'll paint the whole ceiling, but I also get to choose the subjects." So it was agreed. And over the excuse of a man who claimed he was not a painter, we have some of the greatest works of visual art in the Western civilization, the Sistine Chapel. Now our text today has an excuse given. Jeremiah has been called by God to be a prophet. Now the job of prophet was not necessarily the most sought after or most esteemed of trades of Judah at the time. Jeremiah knew that what happened to the prophets of God and in Israel in the past, and it was not a career with a rosy future or many career advancements. Now, there were professional prophets. These were ones who would be telling the people, and most importantly, the king, what they wanted to hear. They would be telling that disaster would never come to the kingdom of Judah or the city of Jerusalem, because in Jerusalem, where the temple was, and where the temple was, God was. Would God let anything happen to the temple if that's where God dwelled? Of course not. But the prophet of God told another story. These prophets brought a hard word. They stood in the face of what was to be said, and they told the truth. The people had turned from God. There was going to be a reckoning, and it wasn't going to be pretty. Thomas R. Stiegman has this to say about the calling of the prophet and the response. He says, "No surprise, then, that when God summons a prophet, the prophet characteristically demurs or even flees. One needs to think only of Moses and his fourfold attempt to deflect God's claim on his future life and work. And for our present purposes, the fourth of Moses' objections is most salient. O Lord, I am not eloquent, either heretofore or since thou hast spoken to thy servant, but I am slow of speech and of tongue." God's reply is that of, as creator, and as it turns out, redeemer. God is quite able to refashion as to fashion, whether thick tongues to speak or deaf ears to hear. You see, the prophets are not ones who, as in our anthem, say, "Here I am, Lord, I will go." They will say, "Here I am, Lord, I am going away. I don't want this job. Give it to somebody else." And so when God calls Jeremiah, saying, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, and before you were born, I consecrated you, I appointed you as a prophet to the nations," Jeremiah's response comes up with something that anything that will disqualify him. And so he says, "Ah, Lord God, I don't know how to speak, for I'm only a boy." Now, the word "boy" in Hebrew is rather ambiguous. In several translations, it's given as youth or too young. The word can mean boy, it can mean a teenager, or a young man. And so we do not know what is meant by Jeremiah when he says this, except he's trying to find a way out of the commission that has just been given to him. And who can blame him? He knows that the office of prophet is a dead end. There's no future in it. It's a job for those who are or were abused and killed. If anything, Jeremiah wants to be as far away as possible from the job God says has been his from the moment before he was conceived, before the time he was born. Jeremiah follows in a long line of those who make excuses to get out of the commission God has given. Moses, when told he would lead the people out of Egypt, boldly states, "Here am I, Lord, send someone else who can talk." Gideon, when told he is to lead the Israelites against Midian, states, "Whoa, whoa, whoa, I'm from the least important tribe of Israel. Surely someone from the big tribes is more qualified." Saul, when told he is to be king of Israel, states, "I am from the least important family of the smallest tribe in Israel. Surely God is joshing with you, Samuel." Or Jonah, when told to go to Nineveh and preach there, he states his reason for running and gives this excuse: "I knew you were a forgiving God and that if they repented, you would forgive. And see, I was right, and now I'm going to go over here and howl about it." For all these excuses, God has an answer. To Moses, God says, "Aaron will speak the words you tell him." To Gideon, "Yep, and I'll prove it to you that you have been called by the fleece, and the troops, and the dream, whatever else you need." To Jonah, God says, "Really? You're angry because I was forgiven and did things that you had no power over?" So to Jeremiah, this. Okay. Don't tell me you're too young. Your name has been on the prophet's board before you were a twinkle in your hand's eye. There. By touching your lips, I have given you speech and given you the words that you are to speak. You do not have to worry about what you're going to say or whether they're the correct or right words. You do not have to worry about the right phrases coming. You don't have to worry about any of that because I, the Lord, have given you the words to speak. Also, know that I am with you no matter what happens.